Greetings. This is part three as we continue to review an Islamic poem titled, O Christ Worshippers. Let's get right to the next topic of interest to the mind of a Muslim 700 years ago. Was he pleased by what they did to him? If yes, blessed be they. They achieved the pleasure of his. But if he was discontented, this means their power subjugated his. The author launches forth with a question, and then he provides the two choices he is able to comprehend and fit into his poem. I assume this is more lyrical in the original Arabic, just as English poetry loses something in translation to other languages. Let us first look at the question and answer it correctly. Then, if video time permits, I'll critique the false choice given. Was he pleased by what they did to him? Okay, I'm going to be as polite and mature as I can possibly be, because I honestly want Muslims to listen and learn. This question is overly simplified, and that is a dreadful mistake. The first error is to use pleased to describe Jesus' attitude regarding the crucifixion. And someone limited to such oversimplification may not be capable of grasping subtle, abstract thought. Here is the real situation, which contributes to the thoughts the Messiah was likely having. Before the world was created, Jesus existed with God, himself being God, sharing God's glory. We know this because before the crucifixion, one of the things Jesus prayed was to have this glory restored. John 17:5, "And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed." Was there some pleasure, some hope, in the expectancy of once again sharing God's glory in God's presence? If the handful of times I've felt God's presence mean anything, nothing in this life compares to his presence. Is there joy? Yes. Is there pleasure? Yes. Is there peace? Absolutely. So whatever pleasure Jesus had regarding the crucifixion was from looking beyond the cross to what came after, what he had accomplished. Hebrews 12:2, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." And this is one of those unfathomable concepts only the one true God could imagine. There were two emotions at war in the crucifixion, shame and joy. Jesus was willing to experience the shame so that he might experience eternal joy with those who love him and worship him. Think about this again. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame. Clearly, the experience of the cross of crucifixion was shameful, not a pleasure. It was so painful, a new word had to be created to attempt to describe it. Excruciating. And yet the Messiah decided, meaning he chose, to allow himself to die this way. Philippians 2:5, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, existing in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to cling to." Jesus existed in the same form as God and had equality with God, but decided to not cling to that position and form, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Jesus emptied himself of all of his glory, the glory Jesus had always shared with God. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him a name above all names, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. When people realize that Jesus is Yahweh God come in the flesh, God the Father gets glory. So the Messiah decided, meaning he chose, to empty himself and allow himself to die this way, so he might experience eternal joy with those who love him and worship him, who love him and worship him of their own free will. Was he pleased by what they did to him? I believe Muslims are sane and rational enough to understand just how evil crucifixion was. But dear Muslim, you close your eyes to what the prophets said and what Jesus did. Your human thinking cannot grasp how God could allow himself to have this happen to himself. And that is where self-sacrificing love, which is described in part 2, demonstrates how far Yahweh God is above human thinking. Now, let us examine the two choices the mind of the Muslim poet imagined formed a damning logical pincer movement against Christianity. Was he pleased by what they did to him? If yes, blessed be they, they achieved the pleasure of his. But if he was discontented, this means their power subjugated his. So the author attempts to present two untenable choices, the first being a confused state. Those who killed Jesus achieved his good pleasure. A Christian is supposed to just roll up into a confused fetal position, as if those who crucified Jesus did a good thing and are somehow heroes. All I can do is screw up my face and begin to say, WT, I'm not supposed to say that anymore. The rational, mature Christian understanding is that those who crucified the Messiah were not heroes. They were the leaders of Israel. Matthew 16:21. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Matthew 20:18. Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. They were the leaders of Israel. They were the Pharisees, the chief priests, and the scribes. They were the builders of Israel. Matthew 21:42. Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is from the Lord, and it is marvelous in our eyes." The Jewish leaders, the builders, had to reject Messiah. This is the message of Prophet David in the Psalms. Psalm 118:22. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is also in the message of Prophet Isaiah. Isaiah 28:16. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a tested stone, a costly cornerstone for the foundation, firmly placed. He who believes in it will not be disturbed. O Muslim, who has foretold and then fulfilled? Not Zeus of Athens, not Thor of Asgard, and not Allah of Mecca. Yahweh, God of Abraham, has done this. Numbers 23:19. God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should repent. Has he said it, and will he not do it? Or has he spoken, and will he not make it good? Yahweh God can be trusted. Jeremiah 1:12. Then Yahweh the Lord said to me, You have seen well, for I am watching over my word to perform it. Yahweh watches over his word to perform it, to bring it to pass. Remember, as part of examining this poem, we must compare Islam's own issues. O Muslim, realize that Yahweh, the real God, Yahweh has made his plans from before creation. Yahweh's plans are of old, and not reactions. The Allah of Islam, however, must react and create schemes in response to the schemes of men. Surah 354, part of it. But they, the Jews, were deceptive, and Allah was deceptive, and Allah is the best of deceivers. In the context, the Quran implies Allah responded with a scheme after the Jews made a scheme first. And only finally, when Allah sent Muhammad, did Allah realize that signs and wonders will be mistaken as evident magic. Surah 61:6. Then when he, Issa, brought unto them evidences, signs, proofs, they said, This is magic, manifest. So Allah did not have a clue how the Jews would interpret the miracles by Jesus, according to the Quran. Were not all the miracles by Jesus, by Allah's permission, O Muslim? That must mean before Jesus worked them, Allah said yes. When you can answer, tell Allah that he too may finally know. And the poet of Islam, author of O Christ Worshipper, gives us a second option. But if he was discontented, this means their power subjugated his. Notice his attempt to use an opposite to describe the emotion. Discontented as the opposite of contented, pleasure, pleased, contented. Not only does this Islamic poet not understand God's message by the prophets, he is on the hairy edge of not understanding normal, basic human emotions. But if he was discontented, this means their power subjugated his. His logic is that if Jesus was displeased, the Jews must have overpowered him. And if they overpowered him and Jesus is God, then they overpowered God. Shock! This argument is 700 years old, and Islam has still not learned. Once you build your foundation with a slant to it, the whole house of logic you build on it will then be tilted. This really is the same logic that Islam impales itself with today. Was he pleased by what they did to him? If yes, blessed be they. They achieved the pleasure of his. But if he was discontented, this means their power subjugated his. Pay close attention to the lack of logical symmetry in the two alternatives the author provides. In one false choice, those who killed Jesus are blessed because they gave Jesus pleasure. In the other choice, if Jesus was not pleased, the poet ascribes it means they overpowered him. Can you see that really does not appeal to a single, isolated logical fact? A consistent logical argument would have to have symmetric logic and conclusions. If it was Jesus' will to die, if it was not Jesus' will to die. If it was Jesus' will to die, the power of those who killed him is not an issue. They may have had more physical power than Jesus did, but if he submitted, we would never know or have evidence of it. If it was not Jesus' will to die, then it is still an assumption they must have overpowered him. This ignores the many reasons given by the prophets of God. The fascinating thing, though, is this is answered by what Jesus himself said. John 10:17. The reason the Father loves me is that I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. So the demonic delusion they subjugated his power is just that. Another attempted demonic scheme by Al-Makr, the best deceiver. But if he was discontented, this means their power subjugated his. It is really a tragic shame. Mohammedans have no regard for what Jesus said. John 10:17, I lay down my life. John 10:18, no one takes it from me. But if he was discontented, this means their power subjugated his. I lay down my life. No one takes it from me. Read, think, learn, and decide you do not want to be stupid. Remember, this is an admired example of Islamic dawah and argumentation from before 1350. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.